Howdy folks, back at it on the old Frigidaire today. Like I said yesterday, I had this fitting in here just for a test to hook the vacuum pump up and charge some gas in there. As you can see, that's just a quarter inch SAE flare port fitting. It doesn't have any kind of a way to trap the gas in when the hoses are taken off. Now you can get these easily at any HVAC store. And this is a braze in or solder in type. The quarter inch port, but you see it has a Schrader valve in there, a little like a tire valve. So when you take the gauges off, you don't lose all your charge. But I don't want to solder that in. I wanted something that would screw in. And they have these parts. I got these at Wittichin Supply here in Tuscaloosa, where I get all my motor capacitors and stuff. And it is similar to that. It's got an eighth inch pipe on this end, and then inside there has a Schrader valve and a service port cap, you know, to keep it sealed. So that will thread in here, and I'll retain that with Loctite. But I need to clean those threads and degrease it, get all the oil out first, and then I'll bind that in there with Loctite. Then we can put a test charge in there and see if the compressor is going to survive or not. I say that because, like I said, it was so tight to get it started yesterday. I'm hoping there's not some damage in it or that it's not actually rusted inside. But the first order of business is to get this fitting in there and let the Loctite be setting up. So I'm going to use a little bit of this brake cleaner that I like so much and a nylon brush. Put a little bit of that in there. I'm trying to clean it but not just fill the compressor with this stuff, because it will take longer to pull vacuum if that stuff's in there. So I want to be sure that those threads right there are perfectly dry of oil so that my Loctite has the highest chance of success. I'll let that solvent dry out. Okay, that's nice and dry in there. Now I'm going to take a new service port and I'm going to clean it with a wire brush. Make sure I've got good exposed fresh brass there. Clean it with a little brake cleaner. Once again, my goal is to have clean metal on metal contact, because Loctite is the chemistry of it. It sets up when it's in contact with metal in the absence of air. And if the metal is good and clean, you get a very, very strong gas tight bond. I'm gonna make a test fit dry first. Fits nicely. Now I'll put a little bit of Loctite on there, but now I've got a ratchet with a socket ready, because as soon as I start turning that in there with the Loctite on it, it won't take it but just a moment to get where it's held in place. I put a little drop on the inside, a little drop on the outside all the way around. I'll start it in. That should be good. After a little bit of time, that part will be lined in there really strongly, and to get it out, you probably would have to put a torch on here and heat that up. I have the valve core out so it won't build up pressure or vacuum before the Loctite sets. They, of course, make refrigerant grade sealants and Loctite, which would be a better choice for this. However, this is what I have on hand, and I know from experience it works in this application. But if you were to go buy all your parts from a supply house, you could get an actual refrigerant Loctite sealant for that. All right, that Loctite's had about 20 minutes to dry. So now I can put the valve core in. Little bitty tiny Schrader valve core. That little cap off that other stem had a valve core remover in it. How nice of them. Put that in there and snug it down. And now I'll put the vacuum pump on. fits on there like it was made for that. All right, fixing to fire off the vacuum pump. Let that run for a while. Okay, I've got the vacuum pump isolated over there. And I'm going to close this low side valve and take the cap off of it. And what I'm going to do is allow the vacuum in the compressor body to draw in some refrigerant oil. Because I know when that evaporator core got punctured, surely some oil escaped. And I'm surprised there wasn't a lot of oil residue, but I mean, I'm sure some escaped. And these old compressors oftentimes seep oil around the electrical terminals. So after, you know, 60 years or so, I figure it needs a little bit. So I got some, the cap off here, some mineral oil. So I'm going to try to draw in about 2 ounces of oil. So it's got 32 ounces in it, and this is 28. So I'm going to try to suck it down to about halfway in between. So I just put that old hose in there. I cleaned the hose, by the way. And I'm going to open this valve. You see the oil level going down? Oil flows much more slowly than air. All right, that's halfway between, so I'm going to take it out. I'm going to let it draw air to pull all that oil out of the hose. You see when that gauge popped up? So what that should have done is let that oil go all the way through and inside the compressor and not all be trapped in the hoses. Because what I don't want to do is just suck all the oil right back out with the vacuum pump. Thankfully, being that that's mineral oil, it wouldn't hurt that vacuum pump at all if some of it goes in there, as long as it's not a big slug all at once. Go ahead and tighten the cap back down. You see, we've still got some vacuum remaining. Now I'm going to go over there and de-isolate the vacuum pump and start pumping it back down. Now, some people might wonder, okay, that doesn't have a Schrader valve, so why wouldn't one just put a quick connect on there like that, like the R134A automotive system? Because, man, that would be so easy. Just put that quick connect right there, and I could use my good gauges, and I wouldn't have to do any adapting. Well, there's a problem with that theory. And the reason is, car compressors have a wide variety of different lubricants, and one of them is PAG oil or polyalkylene glycol, and that happens to be what I prefer for my conversions on cars. So that material is damaging to motor winding insulation. So all the newer electric compressors, they warn you never use polyalkylene glycol oil or even allow residue in the compressor. And then they claim it will cause the windings to short out due to insulation failure. And those people that make those compressors, they don't want to have to give you restrictions on their product. They want to say, this is a tough compressor, just use it. But if the manufacturer of the compressor warns you not to let that PAG oil go in their electric compressor, you know, they don't want to have to tell you not to do something with it because they want to sell products. So if they think it's worth telling you not to do, then there's probably some merit to it. And I know on the internet you're going to find all kinds of different opinions, but I'd rather err on the side of caution than take a risk like that. When I have this set of hoses here, they've only been used on R12 and R22 systems. And, you know, they'd never have had automotive refrigerant oil, you know, leak back into the hoses. So if I were to use that quick connect, then I would be using the 134A gauge set that I've also used with PAG oil, polyalkylene glycol. And there's enough information out there that I think it's very plausible that polyalkylene glycol oil could damage this compressor. So it's a risk I don't want to take. The compressor may already be damaged, but I'm trying to be scientific about it, and I'm going to do some testing of possibly R-152A in this compressor. And I want to run it on a hydrocarbon refrigerant first that I know is fully compatible, and just to make sure the compressor's good. And if it runs good on that, then I'll let out that hydrocarbon and try the R-152A. But, you know, to not introduce other variables that have been known to cause failure, I want to be sure I don't get any automotive refrigerant oil in there, glycol. And that's why I'm using this old hose set and went to all that trouble to get this fitting with the Schrader valve in it. So I got a new can tap today. It'll fit a R134A can just naturally. Then it has this insert here for the R12 cans, and that one would also fit the Duster R152A can would also fit that. But I'm going to be experimenting with using, I think its number is R600, which is also known as butane, which comes in yet another size can. See, this is the Duster R12 R152A same size can. But the butane can is intermediate size. So they had an oil charge can adapter for this. It'll snap in there for the small oil charge cans. And I modified it, made it a little bit larger by taking a hole saw and shaving it away. And now it should fit the butane canister. So when the vacuum is done, I'm going to try to charge it with that. This one's nice too. It has the Acme thread for 134A hose sets and the SAE thread for the old R12, R22 hose set. And they both have a Schrader core in them. So I won't have to worry about it leaking on the one I'm not using. Alright, I'm fixing to try my modified can tap and see if it'll tap these butane cans for a test refrigerant charge. Now, I don't consider butane a good choice for a household appliance due to the flammability, but it does work and it's cheap. And if this compressor is good and it works okay with the butane, then I'm going to move on to some better refrigerants for household use. But for a test, I mean, I got nothing to lose. These are like $3 a piece. Now, I have evacuated the system. Since this charge is on the high side, I can't charge it with the compressor running. I have to inject the full charge and then close off the port and then start it. So to do that, I'm going to start from a vacuum. That way this will be drawn in there. And then if it won't empty all the way like that, I'll warm this up a little bit gently to help drive the liquid out. Now, butane is much, much lighter weight by density than R12, and I did the calculations, and this was to hold 23 ounces of R12, and it's going to take about 10.5 of the butane, and each of these cans has 5.5 in it. So accounting for what little won't come out, I think that charging these two cans in there is going to be kind of right where it needs to be. So let's just see what happens here. Now, if this causes a major release of this product, what I'm going to do is just simply take it outside and let it continue to exhaust until it's gone. Because, you know, we're indoors here, so I don't want to end up with a flammable vapor cloud in here. Here goes nothing. Well, I only lost a little bit. Well, I'll tell you what, that does get cold. Alright, purge the air out of the hose. Now we'll let it flow. That's so lightweight you can hardly tell if there's anything in the can. I can see because how lightweight it is, I'm going to have to go get a pan of warm water to put these in to make the refrigerant boil off. All right, I've got warm water here. That is a coffee pot carafe, but that's not boiling water from a coffee pot. That's just warm water I got out of the sink. I feel it boiling in the can driving off through the hose. I got that too full. Don't have room to stick the can down in it. Try that again. One reason it didn't all want to flow in by itself, the compressor is warm because yesterday evening, you remember I put a heater on there to help drive moisture off into the vacuum pump, and I left the heater running while I went to town today to get the fittings. So the compressor is quite warm, and the liquid is going to go to the cooler area, and if this can is cooler than everything else, that's where the liquid is going to want to stay. So we've got about 40 psi of system pressure. I don't think my water's warm enough. I was kind of scared to get it too hot. All right, the second can's going in. It's pretty cool in here today, so the pressure's low, a little lower than I expected, but we're going to see if it works. I know the pressure of this butane is lower than R12, but it shouldn't be a whole lot lower. And once again, this is just a test to verify the compressor itself is still viable. Don't know if you can hear it boiling in the can on the video. And once again, this water is not hot. It's just barely warm, like a little above bath water. You'd never want to put a pressurized can into really hot water because it could burst. But, you know, common sense should tell you that. Oh, wait a minute. We don't have that anymore. All right, the two cans of the R600 butane are in the system. Take the hoses off, put the cap on. It took a lot longer than I expected to get that to come out of the can and go into the system. And as I said, I had to put some warmth on the can to boil it off in the can and make it condense in the rest of the system. So it takes some patience. All right, I'm going for a start. Current's a little bit high, but it's running. Going down, that's good. I think it's allowed something like 2.2 amps. Hopefully that little bit of oil is going to help it out. Oh, I just realized you guys couldn't see the current. It started out at about 3.2 amps, now it's down to 2.3. The evaporator is already getting cold. I'm so delighted. Now, there's no overload protection on this motor right now because I don't have the YT relay in the circuit, so I can't leave it, because if it stalled, it would only be a few seconds before it was damaged. But, I'm in here where I can hear it if it stalls, and I'm going to be searching for a thermometer to put into the evaporator box. Current's still going down. That's a good sign. All right, the current's stabilized at 1 amp. I'm going to cut the video now and come back if anything interesting happens. Well, it's been running about 10 minutes. And I don't know if you can see, but that's already got ice on it. And the thermometer is down to about 20 degrees. And it really doesn't have very good contact with that, so it's probably a little colder. Let it run a while. One thing I've noticed about these compressors, the discharge of the compressor pump is into the motor housing. So initially a lot of the refrigerant is going to try to condense inside here because of the, you know, there's so much thermal mass and all the parts are cool. So it'll act like the charge is low, but then as the motor warms up, it's going to start encouraging that refrigerant to boil off and stay in a vapor state and come out of the compressor as a hot gas. And then it'll condense in the condenser coil back there. And that volume of refrigerant will become usable in the loop. So this compressor has to be really warm for the system to work its best. I learned that on my other meter miser based refrigerator. After it ran for about 30-45 minutes and the compressor got good and warm, that's when the coil really got cold on the interior. Now I want to let this compressor run unattended, and this relay is its motor protector too. So I'm going to change this wiring. Someone put lamp cord on here. These compressors, the terminals are very delicate. That's one of the sensitive areas where they can leak if you're rough with them. So hopefully all this comes off easily by hand without any force involved. Because this is one of those places where they can fail and start leaking. So far, so good. I'm going to put ring terminals on there. You see how they had done that wiring job? Yeah, that's the guy that sold this refrigerator to the owner I bought it from told him that a licensed electrician had rewired it. So apparently licensed and qualified are definitely two different things. Well, I won't say a lie, but a mistake earlier. Not going to use ring terminals there. What this is designed for is a fitting like that. And that's tinned wire soaked with solder, bent in a hook. So that's what goes on the compressor end. And that'll work on the relay. I don't want to put that in there, because it won't fit flush, and then when I tighten the nut down, it would stress that terminal, cause a leak. So they may have had like a grommet crimped into the wire from the factory, but tinning it with solder will do about the same job. Got some new compressor lead wires in place now. Those tinned hook terminals that I made fit right up in there. There's no exposed shock hazard on there. And I didn't put a lot of torque on those caps, so hopefully there won't be any leakage there. Now I got to get this relay hooked back up. I did find a date on there, 1959. So it looks like this fridge is around a 59 model, or possibly that relay was replaced then. Interesting stuff. All right, did a little rewiring job. This is where the cord will come in, and I'm going to put some other safety stuff in line with it.
labeled everything. That's the lamp feed going out to the lamp inside. This one's for the thermostat. And then the motor, main, start, and common winding are labeled. Go to the terminal points. So I'll mount the relay back inside and try to start it up on its own relay. Okay, the relay's mounted. Gonna go for a start on the original normal starting system. That sounded perfect. Sounds just like my AS76 does. I hooked up a kilowatt meter, which I don't know why they call it that, because it measures more than just kilowatts. But I guess they figured that was just a catchy name. You may have noticed these wires coming out. That's something I added for a test. This capacitor is not a start capacitor. It's only a run capacitor. And it will dramatically reduce the amount of current the motor draws when I engage it. Relay clicked in and out a time or two that time. I bet you that relay is going to need contacts before long. So running, just the compressor running without the this capacitor in the circuit, it's pulling 1.7 amps. If I hook this up, yeah, y'all can see it. Now you see the current drop down to less than 1 amp. What that's doing, it's correcting the power factor. I don't know if I trust that power factor reading because that seems too low. But you see when I hook this up, power factor goes up. That's 74 watts of power being used. Disconnect it. No change in the watts. But yet if I go to current mode, with the capacitor I'm only drawing 0.95 amps. Take it away, jumps up to 1.7. So the compressor motor is using the same amount of actual power, it's producing the same horsepower, but it's using less amps through the cabling and the transformer and everything else. So now that the overload protective relay is working, I'll let it run and see if it cools down like it's supposed to. Well folks, as you can tell by looking, a lot has transpired since the last clip of video. I got the relay and all the parts in the back put in underneath there. You saw the wiring job I did, and well, when I hooked up the power to that, it ran, but I had massive leakage current. And I thought, oh no, my compressor motor is failing and shorting the ground. But I had already megged it at 500 volts and it showed perfect. So I disconnected it. And I found that the short was coming from the wiring to the thermostat and the lamp. So what I found was, under this little cover, that highly licensed, qualified electrician that did this job for the gentleman that I bought this from had done this. And he had stuffed all of those butt splices right inside there where there's moisture. And this cabling here is rotten, deteriorated. So I pulled a new 4 cores of wire. I've already terminated it on the thermostat and done a sealed splice there for the door light switch, and going back together with it. Now, while I've been doing that work, I've had the compressor straight wired and running. And it cooled okay with the R600 butane. But I went ahead and I changed that out for R152A. And it's been running about a half an hour. And as you can see, the entire evaporator core is covered in frost front to back. And that's with the fridge door open. And that thermometer is down to 0 Fahrenheit in the freezer compartment. And that's been with the door open the whole time. And the compressor motor, 2.08 amps or 2.1 amps, which its running current limit is 2.1. So it's working at its 100% capacity, which is to be expected with the door open like this. And I feel a nice warm heat coming up off the condenser, but it's not too hot to touch. And then that evaporator is just ice cold. So hopefully, we're going to have a good success long term out of this. Time will tell. It ran okay with the butane, but I think the pressures were too low. It wouldn't have really had enough balls behind it, for lack of a better word. The 152A is a much better match for R12, but it is more efficient. So, assuming that the oil doesn't end up all trapped in here, then it should work a lot better. But once again, time will tell. I'm going to get this wiring job finished and button it up and probably leave it running overnight, see what we get in the morning. Well, before I turn off the compressor to hook up the new controls, nice and icy, I want to check the temperature. Still down around zero. But yeah, it's cooling well. Well, I got the wiring back together. New wiring and I'll put in the relay. Unfortunately, when I started it up, the relay is kicking the start winding back in a second or so later, maybe two or three times. So I don't trust it, and it's getting late, so I'm not going to leave it on tonight overnight like I had planned, but that'll come soon enough. I'm going to have to take this YT relay apart and see what's going on in there and maybe make a repair to it. So that's it for today. Thanks for watching. Hope you're enjoying my progress on getting this old fridge back together.